So the topic is impaction from oral surgery. Now, what is the definition for impaction? So impaction given by WHO, that is World Health Organization, it is the one that is unable to fully erupt in its normal functional occlusion or location by its expected age. So it is the one, it is unable to fully erupt. So for example, this is your third molar. So it is not able to fully erupt into its normal location or occlusion by its expected age. So for example, the expected age for your third molar is 70 to 25. So it is not erupted at that age because it is blocked by the overlying soft tissue or by the bone or another tooth. So the frequency of the impacted tooth, it occurs in the following order. So the most impacted tooth you'll find is the mandibular third molar. Then it is followed by maxillary third molar. Then the tooth which you'll find more impacted is maxillary cuspids. So that are your maxillary canines. Then mandibular bicuspids. Then it is mandibular cuspids. That is the canines. Bicuspids are the premolar. Then you'll find maxillary central incisors and finally maxillary lateral incisor. So this is the frequency in order of the impacted tooth. Now what is the etiology? So in etiology there can be local causes and systemic causes. The causes for the impaction, first is lack of space due to the underdeveloped jaws. So in local, first is the lack of space. Second, it can be obstructions. So there can be obstruction like soft tissue or hard tissue. The next is the retained deciduous teeth. So the deciduous teeth, they are retained. So it can be the etiological factor for impaction. Then there is dilaceration. If the roots, they are dilacerated, it can be the cause for the impaction. Then the next one is the irregularity in the position and the pressure from the adjacent tooth. So if there is pressure from the adjacent tooth and if your adjacent tooth is not in proper position, it can lead to the impaction of the third molar. Then the density of the overlying or the surrounding bone. And next can be the chronic inflammation. Systemic causes can be prenatal, postnatal, and there can be rare condition. So there can be prenatal, postnatal, and rare conditions. In rare condition, there can be osteopetrosis. Then there can be cleft palate or progeria. In prenatal, it can be hereditary. And postnatal, it can be rickets, anemia, congenital syphilis, tuberculosis, endocrine dysfunctions, then malnutrition. This all can be the systemic causes for the impaction. Then what are the theories of it? So the theories which are responsible for causing impaction of the teeth is, so first theory is Dürrbeck orthodontic theory. So it is like the growth of the jaws. So your jaws, they grow in forward and downward direction and the teeth, they grow in forward direction. So if there is interference in this growth pattern, it will cause impaction, and that is usually due to small jaw and decreased space. So if the jaws, they are smaller, it can lead to the impaction of the teeth. The next one is phylogenic theory, which was given by Nodin. So in this theory, it is basically due to the evolution over the centuries. So the human jaw size, so it has become smaller than the ape-like ancestor, and since the third molar tooth, it is last to erupt, so basically there is no space in the oral cavity and thus it gets impacted. So phylogenic theory is basically the jaw size is getting smaller from the ages. Then the next is the Mendelian theory. So it is the genetic theory. Hereditary, so it is the individual, they generally receives small jaw from one parent and they can receive larger tooth from the other parent, and this can lead to impaction. So if a child, he gets a smaller jaw size from one parent but the larger tooth size from the other parent, and because of that, as the teeth, they are larger and this jaw size is smaller, it can lead to impaction. Then the next is the pathological theory. So in pathological theory, it is like the osteosclerosis in the third molar area, which is caused by the early disease of the adjacent molar, it can cause chronic infection and it can affect the tooth, and because of that there can be impaction. The next is the endocrinal theory. So endocrinal, if there is increase or decrease in the growth hormone, so it can affect the size of the jaw. So basically, there is if there is an imbalance between the endocrines, and if there is lack of the growth of the jaws, and it can lead to the impaction of the tooth. Nature and Nurture, which was given by A.J. McGregory. So it was like, it is basically same as that of the phylogenetic theory. So it's like now there is evolution, primate evolution, and because of that the size of the jaw, it is getting reduced. So this can be the reason for this Nurture and Nature theory. There can be change in the diet of the modern civilization due to the underused teeth. So now what are the indications for the removal of the impacted teeth? So there can be recurrent pericoronitis. So pericoronitis is nothing but the inflammation of the soft tissue. So it is recurrent pericoronitis. So there can be recurrent infections. So there can be infections, because of that you need to extract. So you need to remove that impacted tooth. Then there can be root resorption and caries, which is not preventable. In that case, you have to remove the tooth. Then if there are dentigerous cysts or there are tumors which are present, then the next indication can be if there is a pathological fracture of the jaw. Then there is atypical pain if it is present in that area. Orthodontic, if you require an orthodontic treatment and there is no space present, then the next can be orthognathic surgery, and it can be pre-prosthetic concern. So if there is pre-prosthetic concern, in that cases you need to remove the impacted tooth. The next is the contraindications for it. So first is if the impacted teeth, they are likely to erupt. So if the teeth, it is likely to erupt, you don't have to remove it. Then the next is if it is a partially impacted teeth, and that can be used as an abutment in the construction of RPD. So if it is a tooth which can be used as an abutment in RPD, so you don't have to remove that. Then if there is a medical history which contraindicates the surgical procedures. If the impacted teeth, it is deeply, like if it is deeply impacted and there is no history or of any bony pathology, so you don't have to remove it. And when there is a risk of the surgical complications in some patients, so if there are surgical complications, in that case also you cannot remove. So it becomes the contraindication for the impacted teeth. Now what are the classifications of the impacted third molar? So depending upon the overlying tissue, it can be a soft tissue impaction or hard tissue impaction. So in this soft tissue impaction, there is presence of dense fibrous tissue which is overlying the teeth. So there is a dense fibrous tissue which is overlying your teeth. And in hard tissue, it is due to the obstruction of the bone. So if there is obstruction of the bone, so it is the hard tissue impaction. The next one is the Winters classification. So now this classification, it is based upon the inclination of the impacted tooth. So it is classified into various forms. So first can be distoangular. So distoangular is basically when the tooth, it is distoangulated. So if this is your second molar, so it is distoangulated. Then it can be mesioangular. So if this is your second molar, so it is mesioangulated. Then next can be vertical. Vertical is like same as that of your second molar. Then it can be horizontal. Horizontal is like this. Then there can be bucko virgin. In that case, your teeth, so this is your second molar, and in this it is buccally tilted. Bucko virgin. The next one be lingua virgin. So the crown, it is towards the lingual side, and the next is everted. So it is completely like this, everted in the opposite direction of as that of the second molar. So these are the classification which was given by Winter, and this is known as Winter's classification. By Pell and Gregory's classification, in this it is classified into three classes, that is class 1, class 2 and class 3. So in class 1, it is like when the anterior posterior diameter of the tooth, it is equal to the space which is available between the anterior border of the ramus and the mandible. Between the anterior border of the ramus of the mandible. So this is like, this is your anterior border of the ramus of the mandible, and this is your first molar, this is your second molar. So if there is available space which is present, it is equal to the anterior posterior diameter of your impacted tooth. Now in class 2, the anterior posterior diameter of the impacted tooth is more than the space which is available. So in this case, it's like, now this is the your jaw, this is the anterior border of the mandible. So this is your distal surface of your second molar, and now this space available is basically less than that of your anterior posterior diameter of the tooth. So it is like the anterior posterior diameter of this tooth is larger and the space available is less. And the class 3 is, there is absolute lack of space between the anterior border of the ramus and the distal surface of the second molar. Hence the third molar, it gets completely embedded. So in this, your third molar, it is completely embedded because there is no space at all. So this was the classification. The next classification, it is like, it is based on the amount of the bone which is covering the impacted tooth. So it is divided as position A, B and C. So it is dependent upon the amount of bone which is covering the impacted tooth. So amount of bone, so first is the position A. So in this, it's like, this is your, so in this, the occlusal plane of the impacted tooth is nearly in the same plane as that of the occlusal plane of the second molar. So this is the occlusal plane, so it is basically in the straight line. So this is position A. Now position B is, this is your first molar, this is your second molar, and your third molar is basically like this. So it is the occlusal plane of the impacted tooth, it is between the cervical line and the occlusal plane. So basically, this is the cervical line of the second molar and this is the occlusal plane. So your impacted tooth is between these two in position B. And in position C, the occlusal plane of the impacted tooth is below the cervical line. In this, it is below the cervical line. So that is this position C. Now these are the classification which is given for your mandibular molars. Now there's one more classification which we need to see for the maxillary molars. So maxillary molars, we are again seeing the angulation, that is the Winters classification, and the depth classification. And there's one more classification which we see in maxilla is sinus approximation, and there is no sinus approximation. If there is this sinus which is present and the molar that is present, it is not approximated to the sinus, so it is no sinus approximated. But now if the roots of your molar, it is in close approximation with the maxillary sinus, so that is the sinus approximation. And the next is the classification for impacted canines. So depending upon the position, it is classified as class 1, class 2. So it is depending upon position where it is exactly present. So it is class 1, class 2, class 3, class 4, and it is class 5. In this class 1, the impacted canine, it is present in the palate. In this, so as it is for maxillary canine, so class 1, when the impacted canine, it is present in the palate, and again it is classified into this 3, horizontal, vertical and semi-vertical. In class 2, it is present in the buccal surface. In class 3, it is present, the impacted canine, it is located in both palatal and the labial maxillary bone. So basically it's like, if the roots, it is present in the palatal bone, and the crown, it is present in the buccal portion. So class 4 is when the impacted canine, it is located in the alveolar process, usually between the incisor and the bicuspid. So if it is present between the incisor, so it is present usually in the alveolar process between the incisor and your bicuspids. So this is the class 4. And class 5, the impacted cuspid, it is located in the edentulous maxilla. So this is the classification for the maxillary canine, impacted maxillary canine, depending upon the position. And there was this another classification which was given by Field and Ackerman. So it is divided into labial position, palatal position, intermediate position and unusual position. So labial position is crown in the intimate relationship with the incisors, and crown they are well above the apices of the incisors. These are the two classification. Again, they are divided as when the crown is in relationship with the incisors. So they are in relationship with incisor, and the second it is the crown, they are above the apices. So this is the apices. So your crown, it is above this apices of your incisor. In palatal, it is the crown is near the surface in like close relationship to the roots of the incisor. And the next is the crown, it is deeply embedded in close relationship to the apices of the incisor. So first is the crown, it is near the surface, it is in close relationship to the roots of the incisor, and in this it is embedded in close relationship to the apices of the incisor. Then the intermediate position is the crown, it is between the lateral incisor and the first premolar, or the crown, it is above the incisor teeth with the crown which is labially placed and the root, it is palatally placed. So that of like in the class 3, so this is nothing but the intermediate position. And unusual position is when the canine, it is presal or the antral wall, or if it is in the infraorbital region. So this is the classification which was given by Field and Ackerman. So these all are the classification. Lastly, I am going to talk about the assessment of the difficulty of the removal, like how difficult it is to remove an impacted tooth. It depends upon various factors. So I have covered about wall lines like in one of the video about wall lines. So it will determine how difficult it is to remove the tooth, which is determined radiographically. So this is again another way of determining the difficulty level through radiographs, through OPG. So when you're taking OPG, how difficult it is, we can determine that. So there are different indices. So there are different index which were given. So I'm going to talk about the Warfis assessment. So Warfis is WHARFE. So it is the W is for Winters classification. H is for height of the mandible. A is for angulation of the second molar. R is for the root shape and development. Then F is for follicles. And E is for path of exit. Warfis assessment, and it is done on the OPG. So Winters classification. So if the tooth, it is horizontal, so the scoring, it falls at 2. So it is more difficult to remove that. So if it is mesioangular, it is 1. If it is vertical, it is 0. And if it is distoangular, it is 2. So this is the Winters classification. If it is distoangular, the scoring, it falls as 2. If it is horizontal, again 2. Mesio, it is 1. And if it is vertical, it is 0. Then the height of the mandible. So the height of the mandible, it is measured. So you are taking an OPG. So you have taken an OPG. So the height of the mandible, it is measured from the distal of the seige of the second molar to the lower border of the mandible. So this is the lower border of the mandible. And this is the seige of the second molar. So this is your impacted. So this is the seige of the impacted of the second molar. So height between this, from this seige of the second molar till the lower border, and seige of the second molar should be measured distally. So this is the height of the mandible. So if the height of the mandible is 1 to 30 mm, it is 0. If it is 31 to 34 mm, it is 1. And if it is 35 to 39 mm, it is 2. So this is the for the height of the mandible. Now angulation of the second molar. So this angulation of the second molar is basically, so this angle, it is made by the long axis of the tooth. So this is your second molar. So it is made by the long axis of the tooth and to the horizontal line. So this line, it is drawn parallel to the lower edge of the OPG image. So when you are taking an OPG image, so there is this line which is drawn, like a parallel line which is drawn at the lower end of this OPG, which is drawn at the lower end. So this is the angle which is taken from the long axis of the second molar. So if the angle, it is 1 to 59 degrees, so the scoring, it comes as 0. If it is 60 to 69, it is 1. If it is 70 to 79 degrees, it is 2. If it is 80 to 89 degrees, it is 3. And if it is more than 90 degrees, then it comes as 4. The most difficult, how it is like the most difficult to remove it. Then the next is root shape and development. So it is like when a completely formed root is present, it provides clear point of elevation. But if it is incomplete, so if the formation is incomplete, so it will lead like difficulty in removing. So if there is less than 1/3 is complete, so if the root is less than 1/3 completed, so it is 2. If it is less, so it is basically if it is 1/3 to 2/3 completed, so the scoring comes as 1. Now if it is more than 2/3, if it is more than 2/3 complete, so again there is classification as complex, favorable curvature and unfavorable curvature. So if it is complex, the score is 3. If it is unfavorable curvature, it is 2. And unfavorable, so if it is favorable, it is 2. And if it is unfavorable, it is 1. Then the follicles, it is like if it is normal. So if the follicles, they are normal, score is 0. If they are possibly enlarged, it is minus 1. If it is enlarged, it is minus 2. And if it is impaction, if it is impacted relief, then it is minus 3. So this is the for your follicles. And the last one is the path of exit. So now your tooth, it has a midpoint. So now there is a tooth which has a midpoint and there's the shadow of this coronoid process. So this is your bone. So there is the shadow of the coronoid process that touches this midpoint. So depending upon that, this path of exit, it is like seen. So if there is space which is available, so the score is 0. In this, if the distal cusp, so only the distal cusp is covered, so the score is 1. If the mesial cusp is also covered, so it is 2. And if both the cusp is covered, then it is 3. And now the total of this, it comes out to be as 33. So the score for Wolfe's assessment is 33. And there were many other scales which were given, Pedersen and etc. So this was it for this video. And in my next video, like, I'm going to talk about the surgical removal for this impacted molar and impacted canines. And if you want the notes for this particular topic, then what you can do is you can mail me on my mail ID, which on the Instagram page, and I'll send you the PDF form of those notes or the photos of the notes, whichever it is, on your mail ID directly. Thank you so much.